Hello, this is Colin Goble. The purpose of this video is to show you how to conduct a dialogue with the user, to ask the user to answer simple questions with a response like yes or no, or perhaps other responses to the question that you've posed. I'm going to show you several ways to do this and show you the differences entailed in each one of them, and I hope as a result of this you'll learn the difference between chars and strings and various other features of the C++ language. The first example I'm going to show you shows how to read and analyze user data using the char data type. So the preamble is the fairly standard preamble. I'm going to declare a variable whose name is reply. It's going to be of type char, and as always the declarations are the first thing in the main program here. And a char, you remember, means that reply is capable of holding exactly one character from the ASCII character set, in fact. Okay, we prompt the user to enter Y or N, and we read the user's reply. So I'm going to read one character from the standard input stream, the keyboard, exactly one character, and store it in the variable called reply. I'm then going to ask the question if, and there's a less than left paren and a greater than and a right paren. We're going to ask the question if the current contents of reply, the thing we read into reply, was equal to a lowercase y, or in this case an uppercase y. Let's look at that in just a little more detail. As before, I've used the double equal sign here. We're not assigning the character y to reply. We're asking the question if the current value contained in reply is equal to the character y. So we're going to use the relational operator equals equals here, which is going to return either true or false. Sometimes we call it a Boolean operator, either true or false, depending on what the current value stored in reply is. The double vertical bar here is C++'s operator for the OR operator. It's another Boolean operator. And we could say that A or B is true only if one or the other or both are true. Of course, in this case, reply couldn't be both lowercase y and uppercase y. So this whole expression is true if reply is equal to either a lowercase y or an uppercase y. Well, in that case, we execute this block of code, which causes us to output the statement you entered y. Otherwise, if this expression is false, we know reply wasn't equal to y, we're going to ask if reply was equal to n or uppercase n. And if it is, we're going to execute this block of code. We tell the user that he entered n. And if this is false and this is false, in other words, if both of these are true, we're going to execute the final else, in which case we're going to ask the user to please answer the question. So this is a classic example of a three-way alternation. If reply is equal to y, we're going to tell the user they entered y. If reply is equal to n, we're going to tell the user they entered n. And if neither of the above apply, we're going to tell the user they made an error of some sort. Then we're going to prompt the user for Q to quit the program in the usual way. Now in this next example, we're going to supply exactly the same logic, but instead of expecting the user to enter only one character, we're going to assume that they might type yes or no or something similar. So instead of one character, I've decided to use the string data type. The first change we've made here is that the declaration of reply has been turned into string instead of char. We've asked the user to enter the word yes or no, or perhaps just y or n to shortcut, and we're going to read the reply. Now in this case, the value that we're going to read is going to be a string. It could be more than one character. In fact, what we're going to read is the next token that the user types. And in C++, a token is everything the user types until C++ encounters white space. And white space arises if the user types a space, for example, or a new line character, an enter character at the end of a line, or even possibly a tab character. So, having read the whole token that the user types, maybe yes or no, this expression here, reply.substring 0, 1, the substr function here extracts the substring from reply that begins with character position 0, and in C++ everything begins at position 0. So the first character in the string is character 0, the second character in the string is character 1, and so on. It's a little confusing, I know, but that's the way C++ and Java and most other programming languages are. So remember, things count from 0. So in this case, we're looking at the substring that begins at character position 0 and is exactly one character long. The first parameter here is the start position. The second parameter is the length of the substring. So obviously what we're looking at here is the first character of the token that the user's typed. And we're asking the question if that's equal to a lowercase y, or in this case, an uppercase y. Again, we've used the OR operator here, the double vertical bar, to indicate either A or B. You might also notice that in this case, I've surrounded the y with a double quote because reply and the substring are of type string, and strings begin and end with double quotes, so we've used a double quote here, we've used a double quote here. On the previous example, you may remember, I used a single quote around the y and a single quote around the n because chars begin, the data type char begins with a single quote. So strings, double quote, char, single quote. Other than that, the logic of the program is pretty much the same. So let's try running this one. If I execute this program, if I compile it and run it, in this case I could type something the whole word yes, like that, and it says you entered yes, because the token that I typed began with the letter, in this case capital Y. On the other hand, of course, if I run this program again and I type in no, then it tells me that I entered no. Now we might just notice that if I type in two tokens, things get a bit messed up. So if it says please enter yes or no, and I type in, for example, yes sir, you'll notice it didn't go through the please enter queue to quit routine. And the reason for that, frankly, is because the word sir was the second token and that got read into reply. So that's really not necessarily what we want. Let's take a moment now and look at the final example here, which is reading input one line at a time. So in this case, in the case of this program, I'm trying to read, when I prompt the user, I want to read the whole line that they enter. The first example, char IO, we read the first character they entered. In string IO, we read the first token that they entered. And in line IO, we're going to read the whole line. Now, a big warning here. Do not, if you're ever going to use the greater than sign to do stream extraction, then it's very, very unwise to also use the getLine function that I'm using in this demo. So, in general terms, unless you really know what you're doing, I strongly recommend you not mix in the same program the use of getLine and the greater than sign. Either decide to do everything with token input, tokenized input, or do everything with line at a time input. But you can get into trouble if you try and combine both into the same program. Okay, well in this case the thing that happens here is reply is still of type string. The only thing that's different really is instead of typing in here as we did before, cn greater than reply, whoops, didn't type that quite right. Instead of that line, which is what we had in the previous example, that would read in just one token, what we're going to use is this function getLine, where the line we're going to read comes from the cin input stream, and we're going to read the whole line into the string variable called reply. That's really the only change, and it causes the program to work slightly differently. I'll make one other change here, enter queue to quit. Instead of CN greater than reply, let's change this in this application to get line, and I'll change that one also to CN reply. And now what ought to happen if I compile and run this program is I could type in something like yes sir, and that's the whole line. The first character happens to be yes, so now as you see on screen, it then asks me for the second line, enter Q to quit, and so now I can just type Q, in fact, hit the enter key, and the program terminates. Okay, well, just to refresh your memory then, the first example here shows you how to do input one character at a time. The second example shows you how to do input one token at a time. And the third example shows you how to do input a whole line at a time. And there's no right way to do things. Sometimes your situation will suggest the use of one approach. Sometimes your application will suggest the use of another approach. Thank you.